They know what they show. This argument is as simple as replaying Mr. McConnell's own words. A lot of things happened last minute. I don't know why he's so bent out of shape. Is that how you talk about a group of people that you know are desperate for this? Do you really just casually push aside the concerns of someone like John Stewart? He's an echo. He's not unique. Hey, kudos to Stewart. He's been there from the beginning for these men and women. He's been there from the beginning, okay? But this isn't about him, and he knows it. He's the first one to say that. Where is the commitment to them? Don't mix their priority with your priorities. Don't mix their money with money that you want for things. Don't play politics with the people you said you would treat as heroes. Otherwise, what do you value? What are you about if you can't take care of the people we promised to never forget? Thank you for watching us. CNN Tonight with D. Lemon starts right now.
How do you tell cancer? How do you tell lung disease? How do you tell mysterious illnesses that you have no idea how to even label to, we'll get to you when we get to you? How do you say that?
Things happen at the last minute all the time in Congress. So I don't know why he's so bent out of shape.
Okay. You went somewhere different.
It's disgusting.
It is disgusting. How do you say that, especially if you talk to the men and women, and the men and women who were there and who testified and who were fighting these diseases that you know had to have come from all the dust.
And remember, and that was hard fought too, D. Lemon.
Yes.
I covered that back then. We did the air quality thing. You know, Giuliani, you know, he'll say he didn't know any better at the time. A lot of the people who filed the lawsuits would take issue with that. Oh, but the air's fine. The air's fine. You could see it. The particulate matter everywhere. We knew it was asbestos. We knew it was all the things that had been in those buildings for all those years.
You know that couldn't be good for you.
Of course. And then these people start getting these maladies in such huge numbers, and they wrote it off. They had to fight for this money. Nothing was given to them as a gift. None of this was gifted. You know, when they have to come and sit outside your office, you're not taking care of them the right way. Well, and that's the truth.
Here's the thing, and you always talk about this, term limits. There's a sense of entitlement. I belong here. I'm going to tell you how it goes. This is my job. This is what I do. I decide when it's going to come, what's going to be appropriated, and what's not. And I think that's what it is. And I think, you know, maybe, and I'm not speaking of just Mitch McConnell specifically, but maybe some people who had this sense of entitlement wouldn't, and they wouldn't even be there in those positions to be able to talk like that. I don't know why he's so bent out of shape. We'll get to him when we get to it. That's a horrible sentiment to have, especially about our survivors.
Well, look, I mean, this is how simple the argument is. If I care about this, then there's no condition on it, right? I want this to happen because I think it's right, so I'll do it. If I have to say, hey, Don, oh, you know, I'll take care of this. I'll do the drug act, but you have to give me this. That tells you everything you need to know. Mm-hmm. If he put a condition on it about U.S. oil exports, which was something I will assume that the Democrats were giving him a hard time on, what does that tell you? Mm-hmm. That he thought he was giving them something with the Zadroga Act.
Yeah.
Not that he thought it was what he wanted to motivate. He wanted the oil export issue.
Yeah.
That's all you need to know. And look, he's a brilliant tactician.
Yeah.
He's a brilliant tactician. McConnell is great at the game, but the game sucks.
Tone deaf on this. So can we lift someone up? Right.
Please.
Now, can we lift up our colleague and our friend Anderson Cooper, who we love so much? The network is not the same without him, and we are he is going through something that you can't imagine. Everybody experiences loss at some point, but your loss is specific to you. His is specific to him, and so we just want to keep him in our thoughts and lift him and his family up. And we can't wait to see him again. But take off as much time as you need. What a great lady, too.
She was a great lady. My mother is her contemporary, and they were friends. And she was talking to me about her on the phone today. And she said, you know, she really was one of the truly great ladies.
Yeah.
She was more interesting than most people, my mom said. And she said, I saw her in great pain. I saw her in great moments of triumph. And she was so impressed by her. And I have to tell you, you know, you and I have dealt with a lot of loss. Anderson gave himself some gift with that documentary he did with his mother.
The insight
into her and into him, and he'll always have it. And as we both know, I can't say anything to Anderson to help him with where he is right now. The pain is personal. But boy, did he do himself and his family and his loved ones a solid with that beautiful tribute.
You took it. I had written something that I was going to say, and I said there's nothing, you know, to Anderson directly to camera, and then decided that it was better to talk to you about it because your mom knew her, and we both know Anderson. But listen, she gave him his sense of humor. If you saw Anderson's story on her, or his obituary on her, the giggle. It's the same laugh.
It's really funny. And a little contagious. I almost wound up doing it when I was listening.
And you know what, though? I feel it. You know, you feel it because I'm a mama's boy. You're a mama's boy. I just saw your mom this weekend. My dog jumped on her.
Bit my mom.
My dog did not bite your mom. But
my lawyer will call you a lawyer. We'll see what happens.
But he's so close to his mom. And so, you know, you can't help but feel it. And I know he's going through some things. But again, we do. I mean, we love him and we wish the best for him.
You know, Anderson is an interesting study. He is the biggest male star in the business,
absolutely.
Period. Anyone who doesn't think that's true is not being honest with themselves.
I was at a question and answer session one day, and they did me, like, you know, they said names, and you had to answer with one word, and they were like, oh, you know, blah, 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 and I would answer with one word. And they said Anderson, and my one word was icon, and everyone in the room went, ooh.
Huh. I mean, look, he has set a standard for our generation of journalism, and that's a beautiful thing on television. Yeah. But, you know, people don't give him credit. What they see in him is his reserve. Still waters run deep. And he has such tremendous feeling for his mother. It's so complicated and profound. And he expressed it so beautifully. And again, we've experienced loss. It's not easy to explain to people your love and your sense of connection, even with those that mean the most to you. And he did it so beautifully. And I just hope he can appreciate the gift he gave his mom at the end of her life, and the gift that he gave himself of making that connection with her in the documentary. Yeah.
Hey, listen, we used to go to merry-go-round and Chess King. Every woman I know, every girl I know had her Gloria Vanderbilt jeans by Marjani and the perfume. And it was like, if you had to have the Calvin Klein jeans and you had to have the Gloria Vanderbilt jeans. Speaking of icons, she was an amazing icon. And again, our thoughts and prayers go out to Anderson. Anderson, we love you. Come back whenever you can. But again, you know, take as much time as you need. I got to run. I got a lot of show to get to.
Well said, my friend. I'll be watching.
Thank you very much. We'll see you soon. This is CNN Tonight. I'm Don Lemon. President Trump officially kicking off his reelection starts tomorrow. How else? A great big Trump rally. Where else? Florida. Florida's a key swing state that he knows he needs to win if he wants to remain president, if he wants to stay in the Oval Office. And we know he hasn't stopped running since the day, remember this day, that he descended that escalator in Trump Tower back in 2015. It was July of 2015. June 16th of 2015. And he never broke his campaign stride, even after he won and was sworn in. But before he heads off to Orlando, he has to deal with tension among the ranks of both his campaign staffers and in the West Wing as well. The president is said to be furious over troubling internal polling. Why? Well, they show he is losing to Joe Biden and other Democratic candidates in key battleground states like Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin. Adding to his fury, those polls that we've been telling you about, they were leaked. He got rid of three pollsters after the information got out. And again, in true Trump fashion, what did he do? He called the unfavorable polls fake.
Those polls don't exist. But I just had a meeting with somebody that's a pollster, and I'm winning everywhere. So I don't know what you're talking about.
No idea what you're talking about. Those polls don't exist. We know Trump lives for polls. You know how I know? He used to hand them to me at interviews, a number of them, when I used to interview him when he would go on other networks, except for the Trump News Network. He's watching every single one of them, even the ones that he calls fake. But this president never misses an opportunity to spin information in his own favor, not only denying that the internal polls exist, but also tweeting that only fake polls show us behind the motley crew. There's no doubt that President Trump is worried about Biden's candidacy, and maybe he should be. Biden is the clear front runner among the Democratic candidates, and tonight he's making this bold prediction.
I plan on campaigning in the South. I plan, and if I'm your nominee, winning Georgia, North Carolina, South Carolina, believe it or not. And I believe we can win Texas and Florida, if you look at the polling data now.
A Another thing the White House is focused on, the Middle East, especially the rising tensions with Iran. Tonight, the Pentagon announcing that it's sending an additional 1,000 troops and extra military resources to the region. The U.S. is blaming Iran for attacking two oil tankers in the Gulf of Oman last week. While Iran denies the accusation, and the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, saying over the weekend that the U.S. is considering military action, as a senior Iranian official is telling CNN that the two countries are likely to be headed toward confrontation. We're going to have more on that for sure in just a moment. But then there's this. The New York Times reporting that the U.S. is escalating cyber attacks on Russia's power grid as a way to warn Russia that America is ready and able to deploy cyber tools to combat Russia's digital incursions. But in a stunning development, administration officials tell the Times that President Trump has not been briefed in detail about the program, out of concern he'll overrule it, or that he might leak the information to foreign officials. You know, like he did back in 2017 when he shared classified material with Russian diplomats who were visiting the Oval Office. Remember that? President slamming the article as, of course, untrue, accusing the Times of committing treason. Treason? More on that as well. There's a lot going on tonight, and one thing we know for sure is that this president likes the optics to be just right. Actually, he demands it. I want you to take a look at what happened during his Oval Office interview with George Stephanopoulos when the acting chief of staff, Mick Mulvaney, coughed.
Now, at some point, I might, but at some point, I hope they get it because it's a fantastic financial statement. It's a fantastic financial statement. And let's do that over. He's coughing in the middle of my answer.
Yeah, okay.
I don't like that, you know?
Your chief of staff.
If you're going to cough, please leave the room.
Get a shot of, and I'll come over here.
You just can't.
Just to change the shot.
Okay.
Sorry, Mr. Trump.
Let's do that over? It's all about the optics. If it wasn't perfect, demand another take. So why did someone leak internal poll numbers showing the president trailing Joe Biden and other Democrats? We're going to discuss. Gloria Borger's here and Frank Bruni as well next.
Movado Bold.
Get brighter eyes in a blink.
New Age Perfect Rosy Tone Eye from L'Oreal. A brightening eye cream with Imperial Peony Extract helps instantly correct the look of dark circles for brighter looking eyes. New Rosy Tone Eye from L'Oreal Paris.
We're worth it.
I've got an idea.
Ooh, what is it?
What if we give the people iPhone XR when they join T-Mobile?
For a limited time, join T-Mobile and get the awesome iPhone XR on us.
Applebee's new loaded chicken fajitas, now only $10.99.
Here.
Technology should be simple. Simple to connect with, easy to talk to.
Hey, BMW, where can I park?
And a joy to drive. Don't be driven by technology, drive it. The all-new BMW 3 Series. Hurry in to lease a 2019 BMW 330i xDrive sedan for $429 a month.
This is not a bet. It's a revolution in sleep. The Sleep Number 360 Smart Bed, now from $899, senses your movement and automatically adjusts on each side to keep you both comfortable. And snoring? How smart is that? Smarter sleep. So you can come out swinging, maintain your inner focus, and wake up rested and ready for anything. Only at a Sleep Number store. Don't miss the Queen Sleep Number 360 C2 Smart Bed, now only $899, plus 0% interest for 48 months on most beds. Ends Wednesday.
GEICO makes it easy to get help when you need it, with licensed agents available 24/7. It's not just easy. It's having a walrus and goal easy.
It's a walrus! Ridiculous!
Yes! Nice save, big guy! Good job, Duncan! Way to go!
It's not just easy. It's GEICO easy.
Oh, Duncan, stay up. No sleepies.
Discover.
Hi, do you have a travel card?
Yep, our miles card. Earn unlimited 1.5 miles and we'll match it at the end of your first year.
Nice. I'm thinking about a scuba diving trip.
Ooh.
Or not. You okay?
Yeah, no, I'm good.
Earn miles. We'll match them at the end of your first year.
President Trump says, don't believe the polls. Of course, he's talking about the ones showing him trailing Democrats in 2020. He calls them fake news and even fired his own pollsters, well, for leaking them. Joining me now, Gloria Borger and Frank Bruni. Good evening, everyone. I'd be kind of mad, too, wouldn't you, if someone leaked polls? No? Especially unfavorable ones. Can we just give him... He has the right to be mad about that, right? All right. See, Gloria, you agree with me.
Yeah, I think he has every right. Look, if I were a candidate and somebody leaked polls... particularly if they weren't good, I'd be upset. Yeah. I'd give him that.
Yeah, give him that. Frank, you know, he's calling these polls fake. He's firing people. He's calling fake news. Does he think his reelection is in danger, you think, or is just Trump being Trump?
I think on some level he thinks his reelection is in danger. And I think, you know, you raised the question earlier, why were the polls leaked? I think in part... his pollsters were trying to send him a message because they don't think he's taking it seriously enough. You know, it's really interesting. Last time around, this
You don't think he's taking them seriously enough?
I don't think he takes his staff seriously enough, and I think they're serving a message to him, like, we're here, we're doing this work. You know, this is the reality-based world, and you better live here if you want to be reelected. This is an entirely, you know, he's about to announce his reelection formally. This is an entirely different campaign than last time. Last time around, this was sort of a seat of your pants improvisatory operation because no one really took it fully seriously until the end. He himself didn't think he'd be elected. That's pretty clear. Mm-hmm. This time around, they've raised tens of millions of dollars. Democrats have been talking and scared about that for quite some time. There's a huge campaign infrastructure. There are offices in Virginia. This is an entirely different operation. And one of the things I think Donald Trump is going to find is with all of these people working in this effort, it's going to be much harder to control information. The leaks, which have already been prodigious, are going to be more and more.
Yeah, it was. You're right. Improv. It was improv. Hey, Gloria, for the record, the president's own campaign manager, to what you know, Frank just said, confirmed that these polls were, in fact, real. So why is he still trying to deny?
Well, because it's not good news for him. And I want to agree with Frank here. I think one way to get to the president, we saw that in 2016. I think it's still the case. We've seen it in this White House. One way to get to the president is to go around him, talk to the media, and then he watches the news and he will see that the polls are bad and maybe it'll stick with him. So, you know, there may have been some pollsters here who became kind of the sacrificial lambs, but this is one way to talk to the president because he doesn't want to believe any bad news. But let me say this. This is early. These polls are early. But if you're a pollster and you're trying to run a campaign, it's always good to have your candidate run a little scared because unless you're running scared, you're not going to win. And so I think that this is a president who's used to a lot of people saying yes, yes, yes to him. And if he wants to win, he's got to have people who tell him the truth, even if he doesn't accept
it. To light a fire under him. Well, Gloria, let me ask you. Well, you know when you said he doesn't want any bad news? You remember, what was that, The Wiz? Don't nobody bring me no bad news.
So, listen,
Fox News polls are always bad for me. This is what he tweeted. He said, they were against crooked Hillary also. Something weird going on at Fox. Our polls show us leading in all 17 swing states. For the record, I didn't spend 30 hours with ABC News, but rather a tiny fraction of that. More fake news, Brett Baer. I mean, guys, he's even attacking Fox News.
Well, it started, I think, and you guys know this, it started, I think, when Fox News started having Democrats do town halls on Fox News. And the president, who seems to think he's the programming director over there at Fox, and maybe he is, but maybe. He said, well, what are they doing having these Democrats on wasting time? And ever since that moment, he's been a little less polite about them. And he didn't like what he watched on Bret Baier tonight, obviously, and he didn't like the poll.
Mm. Let's talk about a little bit more about what you said. You said about him, Frank, kicking off his campaign for 2020, his reelection officially tomorrow in Orlando, Florida. He knows Florida is a key swing state. If he loses there, chances are he will not be in the White House. Is there anything that his staff can actually do to manage him now and less improv and more get down to business and deal with the things that you need to deal with?
Well, I don't know, because he is in a very kind of strange phase of his presidency, and I've been watching him over recent days, and I kind of think he's in full emperor mode, you know? I don't like the polls, be gone pollsters. I don't like that cough, be gone Mick Mulvaney. He seems to be feeling both cornered in a way that he doesn't typically, and he also seems to be intolerant of any dissent or any bad news. So what do they do? Well, as Gloria and I were talking about, they go to the media, because he does watch TV constantly. They hope that maybe that penetrates. But I mean, I have serious questions, as I think we all do, about his grip on reality. And I don't mean that in a mental illness way. I mean that in the sense that whenever his reflex now is so profoundly and consistently to call anything he doesn't like fake, to believe on some level it's fake, that I don't know how he gets through a campaign like that, because there are going to be valleys, there's going to be bad news, there are going to be adjustments that need to be made. And I'm not sure that Donald Trump we've seen in recent days and weeks is someone who's capable of adjustments.
Wow. And you, listen, Gloria, Joe Biden certainly seems to get his goat, right? Joe Biden has been on the campaign trail calling him unfit to lead, an existential threat to the U.S. Mm-hmm. How does a Trump campaign counter that?
Well, Donald Trump has called him Sleepy Joe Biden, which I think he'll continue to do. Donald Trump will say Joe Biden doesn't have the energy to be president, and we'll talk about Barack Obama and on and on. But I think that what Biden is doing here, and it's smart, is that what he's trying to do is talk to people about the stakes of this election early on, and this is a way to get out the vote. You know,
do you think it would be better for him to just ignore Trump?
No. Trump plays right into his hands right now. Every time Trump talks about Joe Biden, it's good for Joe Biden, because Democrats have someone, they say, oh, well, maybe Trump is taking him seriously, and maybe he can beat Donald Trump, which seems to be Biden's entire campaign right now. But what Biden is doing is telling Democrats, you know what? There is this so-called existential threat out there. His name is Donald Trump. And maybe last time around, you didn't think you had to vote because you thought Hillary Clinton was going to win. But this time, the stakes are higher. So you have to get out there. So what he is doing is kind of shaking Democrats if they need it and saying, let me focus you on what we need to do here. And obviously, Trump is going to react to that because he can't stand it. And it gets under his skin, which is what Biden wants.
So, but Frank, you said also, I don't know, I think what Trump loves more than anything is attention. Mm-hmm. And so if Joe Biden is constantly leading him in the polls and Joe Biden just pretends he doesn't exist, Trump is going to continue to talk about him as long as he's leading, and it will just infuriate him if Joe Biden just ignores him, as if he doesn't exist.
He might, but Donald Trump is doing Joe Biden an enormous favor because
I think if Biden ignores Trump, it will make Trump talk about him even more.
I don't think you can ignore Trump in this campaign. I don't think Democratic voters would allow it. And I just want to say one other thing. Let's not forget what else Donald Trump is saying about Joe Biden. Donald Trump is insinuating, and insinuating is actually too generous and kind a word, that Joe Biden is not entirely well. Right. And it's something that Trump and Rudy Giuliani and others did in 2016 to Hillary, and it's really reprehensible. And I don't think it's a good campaign tactic, because I think it just makes the president look awful.
The American public will be able to judge that when they see Joe Biden up against other Democrats in debates. So, you know, they'll be able to judge for themselves. But everyone knows that this was something he used against Hillary Clinton. Mm-hmm. And he used it to some degree of success, I would argue. And I don't think the Biden camp is gonna fall for that. And I don't think other Democrats are going to fall for that as well. I really don't. I think they would even though they're running against Joe Biden, I think they would defend him in that circumstance. I
want to play this for you guys again. This is when, during the ABC interview when he talks about releasing a financial statement. Watch this.
Boy, I hope they get it because it's a fantastic financial statement. It's a fantastic financial statement. And let's do that over. He's coughing in the middle of my answer.
Yeah, okay.
I don't like that, you know?
Your chief of staff.
If you're going to cough, please leave the room.
Get a shot of, and I'll come over here.
You just can't.
Just to change the shot. Okay. Sorry.
At first, I thought he was joking, but then is that a look of disgust, Frank?
Yes.
Genuine disgust. Yeah, remember, he's a germaphobe, and remember, as you said, everything is optics and theater to him. I mean, he cares about the show. He doesn't care about the substance, and someone has ruined his take. Let's do it over. I'm surprised he didn't call the makeup person back in to powder his nose while they were at it.
Gloria?
Well, it's like you have interrupted my show, and how dare you? And that's why I think George was very clever when he pointed out, oh, this is your chief of staff. You're not talking about just anybody. You are treating your chief of staff like this. And if I might talk about the substance a little bit, here's the president saying, well, I hope they, I don't know who they is, I hope they release my financials, whatever that means. If it means tax returns, then why is the Treasury Department fighting Congress on that? If you hope they release your tax returns, you can do that tomorrow.
He can do it himself. But he can just say,
exactly.
Here they are.
Exactly. So, you know, we're not paying attention to the substance of that because what he did to Mick Mulvaney was so embarrassing.
And so dumb. The cameras were rolling.
Right.
I mean, he didn't think that this footage was going to exist. And here we are looking at it and talking about
it. Well,
because it wouldn't on reality TV, but it would on the news.
No coughing. We got to do another take. Thank you, guys. Enjoy the conversation. See you soon. The president ordering 1,000 more troops to the Middle East, I should say, as tensions with Iran escalate. But could this all have been avoided? I'm going to ask the former director of national intelligence, Mr. James Clapper. He's next.
Calling all sunscreen haters. You're going to love this. New Copper Tone Sport Clear. Not thick, not hot, not messy. Just clear, cool, protected. Copper Tone Sport Clear. Proven to protect.
Thanks for coming.
No problem.
You're welcome.
This is the Durabed of the all-new Chevy Silverado.
Looks real sturdy.
That is huge.
It has available LED cargo area lighting.
Lights up the entire bed.
It even offers a built-in 120-volt outlet.
Wow.
Plug that in for me.
Oh, holy smokes. Oh, wow.
And the all-new Silverado has more trim levels than any other pickup.
Oh. Oh, wow.
Very cool.
There's something for all of us.
Absolutely.
It's time to upgrade.
So recently, my son's band was signed by a record label.
A record deal? Unbelievable.
Why Blake and Chris chose Verizon.
Whenever we're about to get on a stage for a huge audience, I always give my dad like a FaceTime kind of moment before we do our thing. You see the crowd, you see the emotion. You know, he has that experience for the first time with me, and it's really important to me. I created a rock star.
The network more people rely on gives you more. Like iPhone XR with select iPads for as low as $30 a month. That's Verizon.
Here at IHOP, we're sticking to what we know best. Pancakes. Pancakes with all-natural Black Angus beef. And wow, we even have a pancake with a pancake in it.
Try one with unlimited fries, starting at $6.99. IHOP.
The third stair always creaked, and your mother told me all her life that I should fix it. Now, it reminds me of her. I'm just glad I never fixed it.
Listen. You don't need to go anywhere, Dad.
Meet Christine. She's going to help you around the house.
The best home to be in is your own. From personal care and memory care to help around the house, Home Instead offers personalized in-home services for your loved ones. Home Instead Senior Care. To us, it's personal.
Got a good view there, Neil?
Yeah, I sure do.
This is a legal alert for users of Roundup Weed Killer. In July 2018, a judge determined that all federal lawsuits could move forward against Monsanto, the maker of Roundup Weed Killer, over concerns that those exposed are at risk for developing non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And in three landmark verdicts, the most recent in May of 2019 for $2 billion, one in March 2019 for $80 million, and another in August 2018 for $289 million, it was concluded that Roundup was responsible for the plaintiff's non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Roundup Weed Killer is the most commonly used weed killer in American agriculture, with an estimated 85 to 90 million pounds used each year. If you or someone you love has been diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma after being exposed to Roundup or a glyphosate herbicide, you may be entitled to compensation. How do you fight for the compensation?